without further ado, we'd love for you to get involved in the CGR programming if you're interested. But really, tonight, we're here to hear the stories of some very deep and rich new friends of mine people have gotten to know. I've already heard some of their stories, and I can promise you a very rich evening. Dr. David Barros, would you come and introduce the evening?
We're going to begin with a pretty... Some of you I know, I did care, I retired last year, I'm teaching part-time this year, and I'm a member of Veterans for Peace, as was said. We're going to show a short film to begin with, and then I'll introduce my colleagues who are here to talk to you, and they'll talk for a bit, and then we'll have a dialogue. Can we turn the lights down a little bit in the front?
Veterans for Peace was founded in 1985, and is the United Nations recognized non-governmental organization that is comprised of veterans, men and women veterans of all eras and duty stations spanning the Spanish Civil War, World War II, the Korean, Vietnam, Gulf, and current Iraq and Afghanistan wars. Our collective experience tells us wars are easy to start and hard to stop, and those hurt are most often the innocent. We draw on our personal experiences and perspectives gained as veterans to raise public awareness of the true cost and consequences of militarism and war. The San Diego chapter is a concerned group of patriotic veterans who feel compelled to speak out at this crucial time in our country's history. We feel duty-bound to demand answers concerning the mission of our current service members and to ensure that sacrifices of American soldiers, sailors, Marines, and airmen are not taken lightly nor expended on frivolous endeavors. As veterans with a range of experience and of military service, we act together to help educate our community about the American military culture and concerns. When you talk to one of our members, you know there is a passion, and it's not something you will hear or read about in a glossy recruitment brochure. We reach out to the San Diego community hoping to raise awareness of the total cost of war, the killed civilians, the families of the dead and wounded soldiers, and especially the lost lives of the U.S. military personnel through Arlington West, a memorial to those who gave their lives. The chapter also actively supports reaching out to homeless veterans, providing sleeping bags, ponchos, clothes, and counseling.
Some U.S. military combat veterans called Veterans for Peace reach out to homeless vets, giving them brand new sleeping bags and ponchos.
There is a Coleman sleeping bag, there's a poncho, and of course the stuff sack, keep your stuff.
The San Diego chapter of Veterans for Peace has adopted the name Hugh Thompson Memorial Chapter in honor of the memory of Hugh C. Thompson, Jr., who was a helicopter pilot during the Vietnam War. Thompson and his two-man crew came to be known because of the My Lai Massacre, a mass murder of between 350 and 500 unarmed civilians in South Vietnam in March 1968 by United States Army soldiers. Most of the victims were women, children, babies, and the elderly. Many women were raped, beaten, and tortured, and some of the bodies were later found to be mutilated.
During the mission, as it was going on, we kept just reconning around, started seeing a lot of bodies. It didn't add up, you know, how people were getting killed and wounded. And we weren't receiving any fire. Just, you know, it didn't make sense. There was too many casualties there.
Warrant Officer Thompson was desperate to get these civilians out of this bunker and into a safe area. He'd seen beforehand that what he was trying to do to help the people on the ground wasn't getting done. He was convinced that the ground forces would kill these people if he couldn't get to them first. He landed the aircraft in between the American forces and the Vietnamese people in the bunker. Got out of the aircraft, had us get out of the aircraft with our weapons to cover him, and he went and had words with the lieutenant on the ground. He asked the lieutenant how he could get these people out of the bunker. The lieutenant said the only way he knew was with hand grenades. So when Warrant Officer Thompson came back to the aircraft, he was furious. He told us he was going over to the bunker himself. He told us if the Americans were to open fire on these Vietnamese as he was getting them out of the bunker, that we should return fire on the Americans.
They flew out two groups of survivors. One U.S. soldier shot himself in the foot to avoid having to carry out orders to shoot the innocent civilians. The massacre was reported at the time, March of 1968, but was covered up until journalist Seymour Hersh broke the Neeli story in November 1969. Fellow servicemen refused to speak with Thompson. He received death threats. He recalled a congressman angrily saying that Thompson himself was the only serviceman who should be punished because of Neeli. He was treated like a traitor for 30 years. While 26 U.S. soldiers were initially charged with criminal offenses for their actions at Neeli, only Lieutenant Kelly was convicted, but he only served 3.5 years of house arrest. Decades after the event, Thompson and his crew were recognized for their heroism. Thompson was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross, and his crew were awarded Bronze Star medals. The San Diego chapter of Veterans for Peace honors Thompson and his actions.
Do you want to introduce yourselves and get talking? And I don't know when we would be in. Barry's our chapter president.
So, Mike, right next to you.
Oh, yeah. You can hear me okay, right?
Please use it. We're recording as well.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Anyway, my name is Barry Ladendorf. I'm the current president of Veterans for Peace. And before I start, I'd like to thank Dr. Gates for inviting us here tonight. We're very happy to be here. And we hope that we'll provide some information that will be meaningful for you tonight. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in Illinois in a very small community, a farming community. I had every intention of going in the military when I was a young man. Of course, the draft was on in those days, and so you had to always compute in your career planning that somehow or other you had to satisfy your military obligation. You could either get drafted, enlist, or you could get a deferment, go to college, and then figure out when you were going to do your service, or you could try to avoid it altogether by getting multiple deferments if you wanted to. But I made up my mind when I was a young man that I wanted to join the Navy. I was tired of seeing cornfields and cows and all of that that was in the small community that I grew up in. And I was, when I decided to to join the Navy. I got a deferment, went to college, went to Officer Kennedy School, and the Vietnam War was just beginning to heat up. And I thought, boy, this is an opportunity. I get to go and be involved in a real war. Of course, I had no idea, a concept in my mind at all, what that meant. But I was looking forward to it. And the ship that I got assigned to, the USS Valley Forge, went to Vietnam in the, when I joined it, I actually had to go to some additional schooling and joined my ship in the fall of 1965. And there was not much going on, actually, that first tour that I was there. We were there for about 6 months and then went back to Long Beach, where we were stationed. I went back for two more tours. By the time of the third time that I was there, it was clear to me that this war was something that we should not be involved in. I became very much against the war. I saw the ship that I was on had a surgical team, and we carried a battalion of Marines and helicopters. And we were involved in the last months that I was there, and it was the Tet Offensive, and we were in support of the Khe Sanh, the Battle of Khe Sanh and Camp Carroll, and those involving the Marines. And I saw a lot of wounded Marines brought back to the ship, a lot of dead Marines brought back in sleeping bags. I never had to carry a gun and shoot anybody or have anybody shoot at me. But I can remember seeing these bodies. And finally, when you would walk around the ship, we had a morgue in the ship that it was so full that they would put the bodies in body bags in the passageway so that when you went from one part of the ship to the other, you had to walk past these. And I used to block that out of my mind and think that this has got nothing to do with me. This is the problem for the Marines to have. But I could also think in the back of my mind in private moments, I would think there's a family back in the States that doesn't know it yet. And they may be having a nice time and sitting down at dinner or going to a movie, but they're gonna get the awfulest news in 3 or 4 days that their son or their father or their cousin or somebody they know and care about has died in a useless war. I can remember when I left Vietnam, I didn't expect me to feel this way, but it just comes up sometimes when you don't think about it, you don't expect it. I changed duty stations. I was on the ship for 3 years, and I went to, flew out of Da Nang with about five other service members changing duty stations. On the plane that I was on, it was a huge Air Force plane. There were caskets on the deck to the ceiling. As far back as you can see, there were probably 100 or 200 caskets that were going home. And I was thinking, I'm going home and lucky to be alive, and they're not. And I remember thinking then that I will never support any war. I'll do everything that I can to do something for peace. So I came back here, and I was on an admiral staff, and I was the liaison officer to the Nuclear Weapons Training Center. So I got involved in a really powerful weapons system. When I got out of the Navy and discharged, I remember what I thought about coming back on that plane, and that was what I was going to do. I was not going to. I couldn't support the military. I still had. Not the military, I couldn't support war. And I still had reserve time to do. So I was still in the active reserves, going to reserve meetings. But I was very much against the war and actively opposed it when I could. I didn't find Veterans for Peace until 2005. In the 80s, I got involved in the, I was raised as a Catholic in the Catholic tradition. And in the 80s, I went to the first time I ever saw the Catholic Church speak out against war, because when I was growing up, the church that I went to, there was no discussion about the morality of war. I never heard one priest say that, you ought to think about going into the military and maybe you shouldn't do it. It was all, you better do it. This is an obligation that you have. And so I used to think about the people in our community that belong to the Mennonite Church and the apostolics and that who were conscientious objectors. And of course, all my friends thought, well, well these guys are nothing but cowards. What are they doing? Not going into the service and support their nation. That was an obligation that they had to do. It was only years later when I realized the wisdom of what they were doing. And so I found Veterans for Peace, and I thank this man right here. I walked into a Earth Day event, and Veterans for Peace had a display there, and I talked to Gerald, and he said, here's an organization maybe you got to think about. And I talked to him for a while. I took an application. I went home, and I told my wife. I said, you know, I think that I finally found a group that I think that I can work with. And when I looked at the mission statement, and I guess it was up here, well, maybe you saw it, but it's in. That was a statement that I can believe in, that we have an obligation to talk about the true costs of war. That we have, and that's what we try to do, is to inform the public of the true costs of war. To talk to the public about and encourage our government not to engage in the internal affairs of other nations. To end the arms race, and particularly to end the nuclear weapons and to rid nuclear weapons. And having worked in that area for a couple of years, I understand and appreciate that. Finally, we help veterans and victims of war, and finally to have our nation stop using war as an instrument of national policy. So those are the things that we try to do, and I firmly believe in what we're doing. And anyway, that's my journey of how I got there.
Good evening, and thanks for being here. Really nice to see such a good turnout. My daughter is an alum of PLNU. PLNU, aren't you? Graduated class of 91, and she's been busy teaching school in the community here ever since. So she's very thrilled with the education she got here, and it's really nice to come back and visit the campus. She also got married here over by one of the beautiful little spots on campus. That was nice. Anyhow, my name is Gerald Bunch, and I've been a member of Veterans for Peace for about 5 years. And just to give you a little bit of my background, how I got there, Barry was talking about growing up in the wheat fields or the bean fields or whatever in Illinois. And I was raised in the South, raised in the 40s and 50s. And the whole focus of my playtime growing up was war. It was cowboys and Indians, or, you know, the World War II was just over. We would go out and kill Japs or kill Krauts, kill Indians, kill bad guys, kill. And it was a way to make us feel like heroes. And that was the whole focus of that was, you know, we'd watch the war movies. I'd see Davy Crockett dying a martyr's death at the Alamo and think, wow, isn't that great? And all I ever wanted to do was be in the military when I was growing up. And as a result, when I was 17 years old, I enlisted in the Navy. And shortly after that, I was on a ship in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, chipping paint as the lowest of the low. And I said, there's got to be a better way to do this. So I applied to the Naval Academy, and I got accepted. And I went to college for 4 years and got commissioned. Went to flight school. And about a year and a half later, I was flying over North Vietnam, getting shot at, saying, I'm not sure this was the better way I had in mind. It was off to war. But you know what? I drank the Kool-Aid. I bought it hook, line, and sinker. When my government told me that we had to do this to protect our way of life and defend our way of life and protect our freedom, I said, yeah. That's everything I had done in my life, to play, to my early experience in the Navy, my education at the Academy was all rah-rah, you know. Loyalty, do what the government says, do what your superior said, follow orders. And I did. And I went and I flew numerous combat tours. I have over 400 hours of flying in combat flying in Vietnam. All of it up north, though. I did not see war close up, firsthand. I saw it from the cockpit of an airplane. I saw it, an occasional flak or missiles coming up at me, but I never saw anybody getting their head blown off. I never saw blood and guts. I had some friends that would go out and fly missions and not come back, but never firsthand, right up close and personal. And in fact, when the whole war was over, I was okay with that. You know, I said, well, we kicked their ass. And the only reason we left was because all those people back home didn't want to, you know, didn't have the guts to keep doing it, you know. So we didn't really lose the war, we just, you know, left. And in fact, if those of you that remember history, that's what happened. We actually stopped fighting in 72, but it was 74, 75 when the North Vietnamese came in and took over the country. But anyhow, I stayed in, spent a whole career in the Navy, doing all the things that you do when you're doing a career in the Navy. And I got out, and then the whole Iraq thing started. And first of all, you know, we had 9/11, and we went to Afghanistan and started fighting in Afghanistan. And I thought, well, that's cool. We're going to go kick the Taliban's ass, and then they won't, you know, have us be terrorists anymore. And then we started with this, we're going to invade Iraq. And we're going to invade Iraq to defend our freedom and protect our way of life. And I'm going, wait a minute, this is ringing a bell. You know, this was kind of like my wake-up call to say, what is this all about? You know, because the guys that were getting, guys and gals now, that were getting sent over there were, you know, being told the same thing. And I thought, you know, they told me we had to go to Vietnam and beat the communists so that we could defend our freedom and protect our way of life. But, in fact, the communists ended up taking over the country, and my freedom was not affected, and our way of life seemed to be pretty good because the shopping malls were all busy, and people were making money, and tourists were now going to Vietnam and everything. Matter of fact, I went there as a tourist a couple of years ago. So I'm not sure, but what the government didn't just lie to me. And then I started really getting responsible, I guess you'd say, and looking more deeply into what was going on. And I realized that, you know, I'd been tricked, I'd been fooled. And I had not done what I really wish I had done, which was to say, to recognize at the time that this was not just, it was not correct, it was not right. And so I, right after that, gosh, I don't believe there are any coincidences in life. I think when we are ready to hear something, we hear it. And it was right when I was having these thoughts when I read an article in the paper about this organization called Veterans for Peace. And I said, and I read a little bit about them, checked them out, said, this is the group I need to be part of. So I joined and met some really wonderful guys who had been through much of my same experience, some who hadn't been through my same experience, but the fact is we all had the belief that we were veterans, we had spent time defending our country, we had spent time, some of us going to war, some of us going to pseudo-wars in South America or places like that, some of us going to things that we didn't actually call war, we called them police actions or whatever, but we'd all had experiences of some sort of the military and decided, this is not the way to live our lives. This is not the direction the world should be going in. And one of the things that really attracted me to the organization is that we are veterans for peace. We don't say we're anti-war. We don't say we're anti-military. We don't say we're anti-anything. We have a positive look into the world to say we are for this. We have a definite positive goal that we are shooting for, and that's what we're shooting for. It's a poor choice of words. And we're aiming for.
Still. Yeah.
I'm still in the program. A definite goal that we are aiming for to make this a peaceful world. And now I've got grandkids, and when I see them pick up a toy gun and play with it, I say no. Don't do it. Matter of fact, I was visiting my grandkids live on the East Coast, and I don't know how much time I'm supposed to have, but I'll tell this one story and then pass it on. I was back on the East Coast. My grandson has a dog, and he just taught the dog a trick, and he goes bang to the dog, and the dog rolls over. And I said, Brandon, let me tell you something, buddy. Do you want to kill your dog? And he was kind of horrified. He said, well, no. And I said, well, then don't even entertain that thought. Don't have that consciousness be part of your consciousness. If you want him to fall over and, or her, fall over and be still, say, be still and quiet, or do something like that. But to say bang and pretend you're killing your dog, that's, you don't want that consciousness to be part of you. That's not who you are. And I think that's true of every one of us. I think that's true of every human being on the planet. I think we're all interconnected, and you know, we don't want to be killing each other. And I'm for peace.
And
my name's John Monday, and
movie star.
I made that short film. But I think we all had about the same starting point. I mean, growing up as a baby boomer after World War II, our family participated in World War II. We were the heroes of the world. To be in the military was about the most honorable thing you could do. I grew up in Northern California, up in the Bay Area, and it was a very liberal area, but I'd never heard of conscientious objection. It really was not something that crossed my mind. And when I was 17, I tried to join up with Martin Luther King in a march from Selma to Montgomery. I wasn't able to make it down there, but as an alternative to that, I decided to enlist in the Army. And to me, it was the moral equivalent. You know, we were the good guys, and even in terms of integration, both Eisenhower and Kennedy had used U.S. troops to help integrate the South. So I joined, and I was totally gung-ho. I really looked forward to learning about the military. I went through basic training. I went to advanced electronics school. I volunteered for jump school, became a paratrooper. I then volunteered to be a helicopter pilot, to go to helicopter pilot school. But right about that time, I joined in March of 65, and 3 or 4 months after that, is when the first U.S. combat troops went to Vietnam. And I didn't think much about it at the time. The only thing I knew about Vietnam were these monks who set themselves on fire. And I assumed that that was because they were protesting the communist government of North Vietnam. But as the war started to escalate, and as I started to talk to special forces troops that had just returned from Vietnam, I started to question, what were we doing there? What was our real goal there? What started it? What was the justification? Where was the Pearl Harbor that got us involved with Vietnam? And what really became a turning point for me as I really started to examine the war was sitting in the barracks one night, a bunch of people talking with a special forces guy that had just come back, and he described a massacre, an ongoing massacre, really, where they would fly over villages, shooting everything that moved, men, women, children, animals, much like these Be Lies story that you saw here. That was 2.5 years before Be Lies that I was hearing about these things. And I started not only questioning what was the justification of the war, but how are we conducting ourselves in the war? Was this really a righteous war? And I fairly quickly came to the conclusion that we were fighting the people that were fighting their revolutionary war. They were trying to throw out colonialists, first the French, and then the U.S. And I just couldn't see my way clear to participate in this. By the early 66, I tried to get myself declared as a conscientious objector. They said, sorry, there's no regulations that cover that sort of thing, and you enlisted. You wanted to become a warrior. Now you're saying you're against war. That doesn't fit. I went to some anti-war groups, trying to get their help. They didn't know what to do. They could help people to avoid the draft, but they couldn't help somebody that was already in the military. So with no alternative left, I decided to go AWOL. I was in the 82nd Airborne Division, and in the late summer of 1966, I went AWOL. To make a very long story short, I was eventually caught by the FBI and at my court-martial. I testified that the United States actually had established an international law at the Nuremberg trials after World War II. When they tried the Nazi soldiers for their war crimes, the Nazi soldiers tried to say, well, I was just following orders. It wasn't my fault. But the U.S. had established an international law that was no longer a defense, that you had not only the right to object to an illegal and immoral war, but you had the duty to do it, and you could be prosecuted for not doing it. And altogether, I served a year and a half of honorable duty, 2 years of AWOL, and a year in the stockade in the jail. But I felt much better about that path than had I going to Vietnam and participating in that war. I finally got out in the fall of 1969, after 4.5 years, I guess. And in reflecting on it, the war was still raging at that point. And the peace movement had become very large by that point. And it was the combination, I think, of the people in the military starting to question what their duty really was, and refusing, quite frankly, to go out on combat missions. There was even an aircraft carrier here in San Diego where the crew refused to go on assignment, and there were troops in the field in Vietnam that refused to go out on assignments. The combination of that, along with the civilian anti-war protest, really brought the war to a halt, although it still went on for another 4 years until everybody was brought home. But the message I want to convey is that you can't give over your moral position to somebody else. You have to determine for yourself, is this action I'm taking the right thing to do? Is it moral? Is it just? And you have to square what your duties are to your religious and moral convictions. I could also say that the way I came across Veterans for Peace was very similar, that the Iraq War just stirred all those same feelings, especially when I reflected on, I saw this from the Vietnam War, that veterans who had gone in with guns blazing and just accepted that they're there to defend our freedom, and the war was right, and they killed people. There's atrocities that go on in war all the time, on all sides. It's just gonna happen in war. That's what happens in war. And when I would see troops from the Vietnam War come back and suddenly question themselves, what was that for? Was it worth it? What have I done? And I saw a lot of people become homeless, or drug addicts, or commit suicide. And when I saw the Iraq War start, those same feelings, I saw these kids are going to come back and say, this was a war about oil. It wasn't about our freedom. It wasn't about democracy. It wasn't even about stopping a bad dictator who was killing his people. It was just about oil. And we're seeing the result. The homeless vets on the street, the suicides at Camp Pendleton, what is it, 4 a week now? They can't stand it that they did these things and came back and reflected, what was it for?
About me, but I'll say a couple things. I mean, I identified with many of the stories that were told here tonight. My dad was an Army officer. I grew up as an Army brat. I grew up expecting I would go in the military. From 1939 to about 1975, we had a draft. If you were male, you're going to go in the military at some point. Even if you're going to get drafted, you're going to go to ROTC, you're going to... And some of the people I was served with were like 26. They were trying to raise a family, and they got drafted, and that's terribly inconvenient. I was actually a peacetime veteran. I got out in 1963 before the Vietnam War really heated up. So I was lucky in that respect. Looking back, it was the height of the Cold War. There were still occasional casualties. I was in Korea when we had plane crossers going back and forth, and people were killed. So I wasn't in a combat zone. I wasn't in a combat time, but it was still military. I struggled with the military for a long time. As other peace movements came along, what did I do with my experience as a military? Some people say I goofed up, I wasted my life. And I didn't want to say I wasted my life. But so when the chapter for Veterans for Peace opened up here, I thought, this is for me. This is people who had an experience in the military and they're making something positive out of it, saying I can speak from my experience and say we should work for peace. Not, I made a mistake, I ruined my life. It was a waste. I've seen people do that. So we've done lots of things. together, and I think that's been a good experience. We have any questions for each other?
You know, but I can just say, you know, following up with Gerald and what John said about Iraq, I guess at the time, I didn't mention this in my opening comments, but I think the thing that pulled me into the Veterans for Peace was the Iraq War again, because I thought to myself as I saw it unfolding, it's the same story that we were told in Vietnam. It was the same arguments, the same lies. And the terrible thing I think about war is that the government ends up lying to the people. It's inevitable that they are not going to tell you the truth. And I look back on and every war, even the wars that you say, well, that was a good war, what we were lied to about things that happened in that war. And when Iraq got going, I didn't believe that there were weapons of mass destruction. I used to tell people, you wait until they get there. There aren't going to be any weapons of mass destruction. This is just something to get in. The intelligence has been doctored up. They didn't want to... They didn't want to accept the intelligence that was coming from the CIA. That's why the vice president at the time, Cheney, set up his own intelligence group within the CIA to filter the kind of evidence and the kind of intelligence that they wanted to hear, and they wanted to tell you to justify them going to war. And that was I think the Iraq War really made me think, this is when I've got to get into an organization. I've got to fulfill the pledge that I made on that plane coming back from Vietnam that I would not be involved, I would not support war, that I would fight against it, that I would fight for peace, and I would try to let people know the truth about it the best that I could. And that was a real motivating factor for me of getting involved in Veterans for Peace. And it's a real motivating factor for me to continue to be involved in Veterans for Peace. When I think of the cost of war, I'll just take a moment on this, it's just, think about this, and what you've heard recently. Yeah, everybody here has heard about, you remember last year when the Wisconsin thing was going on, all the people were protesting Wisconsin because of the budget cuts, and you remember that? Maybe not. But let me tell you just a little bit about the cost of war, I'll bring it home to California. The taxpayers in California, the federal taxpayers here in California, since 2001, have paid $150 million to support the war in Iraq. I'm sorry, $150 billion. And think about this, the budget deficit in California, in this that's causing us all the problems, it fluctuates between 27 and then was down to 13 and then they revised it up to 20 again, $20 billion. Think of the fact that all the money the people of California sent and to support the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, $150 billion. In Wisconsin, where they were having the big protests because they were cutting back government services to the people there, in Wisconsin, the budget deficit that was causing the big debacle was $3 billion. The people in Wisconsin, federal tax dollars that they sent to Washington that was used to fund the wars in the last 10 years is $18 billion. Six times the amount of money of their budget deficit is going to fund the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. And that's true of almost every state in the Union. You look at every state in the Union, and the numbers are about five or six times whatever budget problems they may have is going just for war, just for these wars, not the military budget, not the defense budget, not to build new things, just to fund the wars. So that's one of the hidden costs. People don't think about it. It's easy to think about the cost of war, how many people died, how many tanks were lost, how many planes got shot down. We don't talk about how many Iraqis were killed, how many are homeless, the 2 million or the 2 million people that have been internally displaced in Iraq, the 2 million people that have been externally displaced in the Jordan and those other countries, and the estimated 600,000 to 700,000 people, depending on which group you pay attention to, and their estimate cost of the number of people that have died in Iraq as a result of this war. 600 to 700,000, maybe a million people have died in the war. Those numbers get lost in the year. In fact, remember when Rumsfeld was asked, do you keep track of how many people in Iraq get killed? Yeah, I'm gonna bother them. It's just they're not us. They're just another life. And that's the tragedy of war. And you saw the tragedy here of the My Lai massacre and you know about Abu Ghraib and the things that you've heard about, those things that happen in war. That's war happens, it's chaos. Nothing is predictable, you can't control it, and it goes out of control and people get killed and things happen, and that's the way it is. And anyway, anybody else have a question or comment you want to?
One short incident. I joined the Army and was trained as an infantry soldier, and when I was in basic training, one of our drill sergeants said, "You're a professional killer." And that shocked me. I mean, I grew up pro-military, but I never thought of myself as a professional killer. That's the role of the military. That's the role of the military. There's no purpose other than being the killer. And if we think of it that way, perhaps we would be less militaristic.
I got one. At the time I was looking to get myself declared a conscientious objector, the rules were that you could, not if you were already in the Army, but if you were facing the draft, you could if you had a religious objection to war. It wasn't enough to just have a moral objection or a legal objection, saying that, well, there hasn't been a war declared by Congress since World War II, so therefore it's not a war, I don't want to participate in. You couldn't take those kind of arguments, or you couldn't take the argument that this is an unjust war being fought in an illegal manner. That wasn't cause for conscience. It had to be religious. And I was never able to square exactly how the Christian chaplains could encourage the troops to go to war, because it seemed to me that the Christian message was very much anti-war and nonviolent, the message of Christ. And I got into a fairly heated discussion about this with the chaplain just a few months before I got out. And this poor guy had a family, and this was in Fort Ord up in Monterey, California. He had a family, and he was facing, should he re-enlist or should he go back home to his parish, which was in Louisiana, very poor parish, and he would live in poverty if he went back. And he was really on a dilemma about this, and I challenged him. I said, well, does your faith really support the idea that you're sending these kids out to kill? Is that the Christian message? And he started crying and saying, no, it obviously wasn't, but he couldn't afford to take his family back to Louisiana. It was such a poignant moment for me. And, you know, so especially here at this university, I think people ought to reflect on what is the Christian message about war?
May I interject a couple of words here? I was a career chaplain for 31 years, and I went to Vietnam. I was in the same amphibious ready group that he was in. My ship was in that amphibious ready group. I went there from a year of postgraduate study at Harvard University. Navy had sent me there, paid my expenses. The paper I wrote for Dr. Harvey Cox, whom some of you may know, was about Vietnam. The study I did on Vietnam helped me to understand that they had been at civil war. They started their civil war 150 years before the Magna Carta was signed in 1215. It had been escalated by the French, and now our noble leaders felt like we could do a better job than the French. So they told the lies to people like this. I knew from my pastoral experience that the soldiers and Marines who were there were victims of lies. That there were people who had been taught to dehumanize those who are different or those who oppose. They didn't make those decisions. Many of them came from poverty. Many of them came from no opportunity to do anything. But they needed ministry. They needed ministry. They needed someone to tell them about repentance, someone to tell them about forgiveness, someone to help them find a new way for their lives when they had that opportunity. So I stayed with that for the 31 years. I taught a course at the Naval War College titled Faith and Force, Religion, War, and Peace. Co-taught it with a rabbi and a Muslim. We had students in that seminar from all of our armed forces, from 14 foreign nations, which included Israel and several Arab nations. In that seminar, for the first time in the lives of many of them, they sat down and got to know someone from another tradition as a person. See, that's the whole problem, in my view, is humankind differs from the animal world in that we do not collaborate. We do not see that our survival as a species is bound in the necessity that we understand one another, that we care about one another, that we embrace one another as brothers and sisters. And if we could get into a collaborative mode, because that's what the animal species do, our survival is all tied up in being able to do that, to embrace humankind. I see, because I chair the Uptown Service Center in North Park, where we deal with about 1,700 homeless a month. I've seen veterans now from the Middle East wars. And like you, I can't look at the wall, because men whose names I cannot call, but whose faces I'll never forget, their names are on that wall, and they died for nothing. So, yes, I helped many a sailor and Marine get a conscientious objector discharge when it was genuinely based on their religious conviction. And I took a lot of flack from my commanding officers, you can believe, but that was their right. So, not everybody, by any stretch of the imagination, that commits themselves to that many years in the service does so because they believe in every practice and principle. So I just want to say that there are some. I was chaplain of the FBI Academy, and I remember many a night going out there at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning to talk to a new agent, because he was now at the point in his 16-week training where he had to shoot at human targets. And he couldn't go to sleep because he knew in his own heart he could not take another life. Did the same thing with Marine officers at Quantico, who knew they could not do that. They needed someone to talk to. And so while I was shot at, but I never carried a weapon, I never fired a weapon, but I feel like my service was useful to some people. And I'd like to say that if you're thinking about vocation, think about religious vocation that does what these gentlemen are talking about now, and that is to promote peace, love, justice in our world.
Thank you. And that kind of, the direction, I think, of where we're going with Veterans for Peace, and what really captivated me once I got into this was to start looking back at history and looking at, you know, we talked about the Vietnam War, we talked about the Iraq War, we could go into many other wars, but what I would hope that you would get out of this as the next generation, our future and all that, is a question with deep sincerity what you're being told by your government, what you're being told by your peers, what you're being told by the social media as to what is right, what is wrong, what's really going on. Because when it's all said and done, you have to make the decision yourselves. I made a decision and went one way, Barry made it went one way, John, we all have to make decisions. And I would hope that when you leave this meeting tonight, or as you continue your education, you'll make your decisions based on a sense of history and a sense of the future and a sense of where you are now. One of the neatest books I ended up reading out of this whole thing was The History of the American People. Howard Zinn, is that the name?
Howard Zinn, yeah.
The People's History of America, yeah. Which was an alternative view of history throughout all the stuff I had learned way back when I was a kid in high school and stuff. So.
Yeah, I'd just like to thank Reverend Riggs, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for your comments there. And I'd like to just follow up on one thing that he said about forgiveness. Remember when you saw the film that we gave to you about the My Lai massacre? And I think the 30-year anniversary of that massacre, CBS television did a special on that. And Hugh Thompson and his gunner there went back to My Lai. And that's where they met some of the people that were there at the My Lai massacre. And they went back to join the Vietnamese people in that community. And one of the Vietnamese ladies turned to Hugh Thompson and said to him, "Where are the rest of them?" And he said, "What do you mean the rest of them?" And she said, "I mean the rest of the soldiers who were here that were doing the massacring. Where are they?" And Hugh said, "Well, I don't know. I don't know why they're not here. I don't know where they're at." And she said, "That's really too bad, because we wanted to forgive them." I thought that was a very powerful message of forgiveness.
I wanted to mention one other thing relevant to this, is I have seen a couple of historians have said during World War II, from 10 to 25% of soldiers who were armed and had position to shoot at an enemy shooting at them, only 10 to 25% fired their weapons. Which many Americans at that time period had been raised with the idea you should not kill. I wonder what it is today. I wonder. I mean, we have much more video games, the military uses video games to teach you how to kill, and we depersonalize it. And so I fear that it wouldn't be 25% wouldn't shoot an enemy if an enemy was shooting at them today.
I can tell you, if you read the book On Killing by Lieutenant Colonel Grossman, who taught at West Point, his book in On Killing, he answers that question. He talks about how 10 or 15 or 20% of the people did not shoot, or only 10 or 15%, 20% shot their weapons during World War II. And the military decided they had to do some changes. And one of the things that they realized is that during World War II, what they used for target practice were targets, you know, with the bullseye in the middle. And so they weren't making it real enough. And so by the time the Korean War and the Vietnam War came about, they started using human silhouettes. And they started creating these little villages where they'd ping people through, and they'd create war situations that were more realistic so that they could break down the barriers that you have to killing other people and make it more realistic so that you had to kill. And the figures, by the time the Vietnam War came around, the numbers were closer to 90% of the people were shooting their weapons, and now it must be 100%.
Some of you have probably seen a bumper sticker one of my colleagues in the Church of the Brethren created that says, when Jesus said, love your neighbor, I think he meant, don't kill them.
Well, that reminds me of the saying of that general that we when they destroyed a village with napalm, said, well, we had to kill them in order to set them free.
We had to destroy in order to save them.
That was it.
Anyway, do any of you have questions?
Don't be afraid to ask anything.
I was wondering what you all thought about, you remember the body count was the deal. Yeah. And then, eventually McNamara served with Kennedy and Johnson. He even say what y'all were saying. And mm-hmm. When you were serving, how did you feel about the measure of victory was the number of bodies? And do you think that might have been what led to the melee?
Well, from my point of view, it was seeing, like I said, hearing these stories of Nilay massacre type things, and not just that. I mean, just the idea of flying over villages and shooting everything. I don't know if you noticed at the very front of the film, there's these shots that were very common where planes fly over villages and drop napalm and these huge explosions go on. Well, that's not combating troops on the other side. When you napalm a village, you're killing babies and old people and women. To me, I got out as soon as I learned that's the kind of war that was going on. It wasn't troops against troops. It was U.S. troops against a civilian population that were fighting for their freedom. We weren't fighting for our freedom. They were no threat to us. And we had not only no regard for human life, but we didn't even have regard for the South Vietnamese soldiers. I mean, they were talked about with derision, and when these guys were telling the stories of flying over villages and shooting everything that moved, they weren't saying it in shame or any kind of regret. They're boasting about it, killing these gooks, and again, have no regard for the South Vietnamese soldiers even. So later when I learned that McNamara knew as early as 1964, the year before I joined, that it was going to end the way it did, and that there was no threat to the U.S. from a domino effect, which was the justification that the public was fed, that if South Vietnam fell, then New Zealand would fall, and they'd be on the beaches in L.A. He knew that back then. In fact, he resigned because of it eventually. I mean, he carried forward the war through the Great Escalation, and finally resigned. But he knew from 1964, this is the McNamara, the Secretary of Defense, and the architect of the whole buildup in Vietnam, knew how it was going to end. So the 70,000 U.S. troops, the millions of Southeast Asians, civilians, all died for a lie that the guy knew was a lie. And so it was quite upsetting to me to read his book where he admitted it. In fact, I refused to buy it when it came out. I waited to buy a used copy for 25 cents. Anyway, that was my view of it, but you guys stayed in the military.
Well, I stayed in. I was kind of oblivious to all that. I was, as I said, I flew up north. I didn't see war up close and personal. But going back to, we've talked a lot about Vietnam because that's a lot of our experience. My reading and study of things since then is that this is not unusual in any wartime event. And we look at Darfur and we say those creepy bad guy Muslims are going in there leveling these villages, raping the women, killing the livestock, and driving them all to refugee camps. They're terrible. And I think, wait a minute, if you go back in our history, we did the same thing to the Native Americans, only we called it reservations instead of refugee camps. We participated in massacres and we did all this. Now, is that because we're inherently bad? And I have to say, I don't think anybody is inherently bad. I think it's something that you get caught up in and get told that what you're doing is the right thing. And when you get in a combat situation, you're not really thinking of mom and apple pie and all that. You're thinking of your buddies around you. I've talked to plenty of our combat troops. And I know it was the way in the aviation business. You didn't worry about, in the heat of the moment, in the combat situation, you're not thinking about Are we doing the right thing for our government? Are we doing the right thing to save the world and all that? You're thinking about, you know, is my wingman okay? Am I okay? Are we going to get back to the ship? Is, you know, it's very focused on the peer group. And right now, and that's the same way that I've heard over and over again from troops on the ground in combat. It's not the big picture stuff. It's the right now, living in the now, living in the moment.
Absolutely.
And when we start thinking big picture, where do we want to go with our government? What do we want to have as a way of life? What do we want to have as a statement as Americans or humans? Not Americans versus the Russians versus the Iraqis versus the Iranians, but as human beings, how do we want to interact? How do we want to be in the world? We have to realize we're all the same. You know, there's people, there's 18 and 20 year old guys in Iran right now that are being told they have to go fight the Americans, just like we're being told the Iranians are crazy and we're going to have to go do something with them. And the people that are telling them this are mostly the rich people in power who are trying to defend their own turf, their own ground. So that's my cynical view of the world as it is.
And we've heard some words tonight of derogatory terms. One of the things to get soldiers to go to war is you dehumanize the enemy. Their slopes, their nips, their krauts, they're not people. And you take away their humanity, and then it's easier to attack them. And we've all learned those words. We've said some of them tonight, and I try not to use those words.